Welcome to the kingdom.
Surrounds us at the kingdom where heaven and earth. everything. I'm gonna need y'all to sing it with us. Y'all ready? Y'all sure? Y'all ready? Here we go. There's only one. There's only one.
There's only one.
Receive. Oh, Lord, I know you can hear me when
heavens, Father. You promised, God. You promised, God. When I praise, I know you hear me.
And I praise when I praise your name. Say praise, praise when I praise, praise, praise when I praise your name. Give God a hand, praise everybody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And Father, we do praise you. We do glorify you. And we do magnify you. In Jesus' name. Another hand praise to the Lord, everybody. Greet somebody near you and say, good to see you tonight. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, don't start nothing, man. Don't start nothing deep. Don't start nothing. Don't start nothing deep. Don't start nothing deep. All right, all right, all right. So I guess that makes me royalty. And it gives me the dominion, yes. Everything I do is best. Anybody got any rhythm? Anybody got any rhythm? I see you, Patricia. Hand clap, come on. I see you, Pam. I see you, Lisa. I see you, Lacey. On a Tuesday night, let's throw him a party. I want you to dance like you're gonna see your breakthrough tomorrow. Come on, pick your feet up. Dance like you're gonna see your breakthrough tomorrow. Move, move. I see you. 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 So you mind it? Everybody. Come on. Praise like your breakthrough tomorrow. For those of you joining us live, we just gonna throw God a praise party on a Tuesday night. It's not wrong here. And waving in the air. And waving in the air. And waving in the air. I see you, I see you, I see you guys. All right, all right, all right. Stop, 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 y'all stop, y'all stop, y'all stop, y'all stop. all right, Dick, stop this. Stop this, stop. Y'all, give God a praise. you know we having a joyful time in the Lord when the people that's serving behind the scenes moving their feet. I see Patricia moving her feet. Deacon, hey, look, Deacon Hollis moving his feet. There is a God anytime you get that Alabama boy to move his feet. But see, Deacon Hollis, there is a God. Woo! High five, somebody says all about him. Come on, tell him. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of our life-changing King. Grace to those of you that's watching us online. That's why we encourage you to come to Bible Study 75. I'm going to say it again. That's why we encourage you to come to Bible Study 75. Because Bible Study 75 is alive. Yeah. Amen, amen. And it's not fake. It's called Jesus Joy. It's called Jesus Joy. We ain't have to take nothing to bring us in here and get happy. Amen. BJ, can I come on the floor tonight? Okay, cool. All right. All righty then. Yeah, I mean, man, anytime you get Deacon Philip Hollis, Alabama Crimson Tide moving their feet. Now, we expect Deacon Zoe, because Zoe going to move his feet because he's from Detroit. See, they think they from Motown. He still think he from Motown, you know what I mean? He think Barry Gordy is still signing his contract, you know what I mean? He ain't hear nothing I said back there. He just ignored me from Detroit, but that's all good. Amen. Yeah, it's too late now. Now he wants to respond. You know, Detroit folk, Joseph, they from Motown. Tim, everybody was there, you know what I mean? So they think they rhythmically born with rhythm. Not. All right. I just love being with my people. Anybody love being with your people? Yeah. It is my prayer that you know your pastor love being with our people. I just love our people. Amen. Let's pray. We're going to get into the word. Father, we thank you again. And as pastor and lead sheep, as my bishop would say, we thank you for the joy of the Lord that's in this place. It could be just the opposite. And I know a lot of us didn't receive good news this week. I'm comforting my own mother, Father God, concerning the death of her niece and my first cousin. But still, because my first cousin and my mom and we all know you, there's still joy in the Lord, Father. And we just thank you for that, Father. And I do pray for my family. I pray for my mother concerning the death of her niece, Eloise, and my first cousin, Father, for the entire family as we celebrate her life. She knew you, and that's what's most important, Father, in Jesus' name. So again, we thank you for your joy that's not based on circumstances. We thank you that, Father, it doesn't matter what goes on around us. Sometimes we have to do it by faith, but still we give you a sacrifice of praise. Now, Holy Spirit, none of this will be effective without you. We need you to teach the church because you are the teacher. So give us all an understanding. Speak for your servants are listening in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to be in the one-year Bible today. For those of you that's watching us online and for those of you that may be present, I've taken our church, I've taught my church through the one-year Bible ever since 2001. And this is the one-year Bible that we got introduced 2 years ago. My mentor, the late Gordon Lindsay, founder of Christ for the Nations, his wife, Mother Frieda, she read through the Bible. I used to read her articles, and she said, this is my 33rd year reading through the Bible. And when I read that, I challenged myself to read through the Bible. And we've been doing it ever since 2001. So let's thank God for the one-year Bible. Amen. All right, we're going to be on April the 12th. Anybody know April the 12th? Thank you. That's a special day. And since it's my birthday, I can teach what I want to teach on my birthday. Joshua chapter 5. Joshua chapter 5. They don't know. My wife said Joshua, which I don't know is Joshua is my daddy's name. Look, he was supposed to be a preacher. His mama named him Deacon Starissa and Kamisha Joshua Elijah. He was supposed to be the preacher, but his older brother's the preacher. So he's the deacon, but his mama named him Joshua Elijah. She thought he was going to be a preacher, but he became a deacon. Again, Father, we thank you for your word. Speak for your servants that are listening in Jesus' name. Amen. Joshua chapter 5. verse 1 through 9, the New Living Translation. We can stand tonight, amen, if we could, for the word. You tell Elder Michelle, we was clapping so much on that first song, I felt like I was doing curls. I said, oh, I'm getting a little tired. We was like this, Joseph. And after a while, I was like, oh, I'm starting to get tired now. You know what I mean? So I just, all right, we'll praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. You get a spiritual workout when you come to the kingdom. Joshua chapter 5, verse number 1, and it reads, when all the Amorite kings west of Jordan and all the Canaanite kings who lived along the Mediterranean coast heard how the Lord had dried up the Jordan River so the people of Israel could cross, they lost heart and was paralyzed with fear because of them. See, right there, Josette, a good preacher would stop and tell you, your enemy is more afraid of you than you realize. I'm going to say it again. Watch this, Maxine. I just said something right there. What they had, we have. If the enemy was scared of them, you need to know the devil is scared of you. Every time you wake up, throw your feet on the floor, he ought to say to his demons, they up again. And his little demons ought to go scurrying in different directions. Amen? It says, when all the Amorite kings west of Jordan and all the Canaanite kings who lived along the Mediterranean coast heard how the Lord had dried up the Jordan River so that the people of Israel could cross, they lost heart and was paralyzed with fear. They did what? Now look at somebody and say, the enemy, it really is scared of you. Tell them. Look at somebody else and tell them the same thing. Tell them. They lost heart and was paralyzed with fear because of them. At that time, the Lord told Joshua, make flint knives and circumcise this second generation of Israel. Now, for all the brothers that's present, relax. It went over their head. For all the brothers that's watching, relax. You know, you're cursing. I can tell by y'all laughing. Oh! At that time, the Lord told Joshua, make flint knives and circumcise this second generation of Israelites. So Joshua made flint knives and what?
Circumcised.
Don't say it so forcefully. you make all those brothers want to run up out of here. And the Lord told Joshua, make flint knives and circumcise this generation of Israelites. So Joshua made flint knives and circumcised the entire male population of Israel at Gibroth Halaroth. Amen. I tried. I could just borrow from Chuck Swindoll, and when Chuck Swindoll is reading a difficult word, he'll read, then it's a difficult word, and keep reading. Chuck Swindoll, read. Hard word, he said, hard word, hard word, hard word, next word. Don't laugh, because none of y'all know how to speak Greek or Hebrew either. So, Joseph, listen, Joshua had to circumcise them. Had to circumcise them because all the men who were old enough to fight in battle when they had left Egypt had died in the wilderness. Those who left Egypt had all been circumcised. This is the fourth time he's mentioned circumcised. But none of those born after the Exodus during the years in the wilderness had been circumcised. The Israelites had traveled in the wilderness for 40 years until all the men who were old enough to fight in battle when they left Egypt had died. For they had disobeyed the Lord, and the Lord vowed he would not let them enter the land he had sworn to give us, a land flowing with milk and honey. So Joshua circumcised their sons, those who had grown up to take their father's places, for they had not been circumcised on the way to ladies, y'all are saying that too strong. For they had not been circumcised on the way to the promised land. After all the males had been circumcised, they rested in the camp until they were healed. Then the Lord said to Joshua, today I have rolled away the shame of your slavery in Egypt. So that place was called Gilgal. to this day. The word of the Lord has blessed me, grant us understanding, and everyone said amen.
Amen.
High five your neighbor to your left or right. Say it's all about him, and I'm preparing to meet him. Tonight's Bible study lesson is entitled The Christian and Circumcision. The Christian and what?
Circumcision.
We read the word circumcised in our text several times. Amen? And what I need us to understand is whenever we study, Deaconess Maxine, whenever we study the book of Joshua, and Joshua is one of our favorite books. Does anybody like Joshua? Until when you get up to chapter 13, then they start talking about all those names and all the land, and then it's just, oh, man, it's kind of rough right there, amen? But when we study, here's what I want you to see. When we study Joshua and the children of Israel, we can learn from their example some principles and patterns. We can learn from their example some what? And it's important to note that, listen, there were some things that Joshua and Israel done prior to crossing, and there's some things they done, Carmen, after they crossed. Okay, let me say it again. There's some things, God's son, that God needs you to do before you go into what he's about to give you. And then there's some things you need to do after you've gotten over into the place he has given you. Okay, I'm going to say it again. On this side of Jordan, Kamisha, there were some things that they were required to do. Once they got over on the other side of Jordan, there were some things that they were required to do. Okay, you're still looking at me like this is something thrown off. So watch this. On this side of Jordan, Carla, here's what you read in Joshua 3:5. In Joshua 3:5, the King James Version, here's before they crossed. Prior to them crossing, here's what we read. And Joshua said unto the people, this is Joshua 3:5, King James Version. And Joshua said to the people, sanctify yourselves. New Living, purify yourselves. Watch this now. And Joshua said unto the people, watch this, sanctify yourselves. Watch this. What I want you to catch is, for tomorrow. What you do today is going to, you got it. What you do today, Cheryl, is for what? What I do with God in my preparation today is for my tomorrows. This ain't something cute. Listen, I'm trying to teach you. What you're doing today is to prepare you for your tomorrow. Now, let me show you, Joseph, what God wants you to expect if you do it right in preparing yourself. Because what he said, please stay with me there, Patricia. Joshua said unto the people, he ain't just telling us just to do anything. He said, watch this, Minister Vincent, sanctify yourself. Sanctify yourselves. This is a personal responsibility. Sanctify yourselves for tomorrow. Why? This should be your motivation. For tomorrow the Lord will do wonders. Now, this is before they even went over. So you need to ask somebody, when somebody looking at you said, why are you on these extended times of consecration? Because I'm preparing myself for my tomorrows. Why are you not just hanging out loosely and going here and going there and doing this and doing that? You're watching what you watch, watching what you listen to. You're not just running with everybody because I'm sanctifying myself. Because God is about to do something in my tomorrows. And watch this. And the Lord will do. I feel my afro right now. Believe it or not, when I said that, I felt hair grow on my head, Pam. Listen, for tomorrow, the Lord will do wonders. Okay. Don't go there, essential team. The Common English Version replaced wonders with wonderful things. The Good News Translation replaced wonderful with perform miracles. The CEV, Common English Version, replaced wonders with amazing things. I don't know about you, but I want to prepare myself for some wonders. I want to prepare myself for some wonderful things. I want to prepare myself for some miracles. I want to prepare myself for some, listen, for some amazing things. And if I do it the right way, God's way, it'll start affecting me tomorrow. God have mercy. God have mercy. That's good teaching, Pastor Mo. So my desire is that our kingdom family apply some of these same principles and patterns that we can collectively and individually cross over into everything that God the Father has promised us in this life. Stay with me. Some churches, Elder Verna, are known for their choirs. Nothing wrong with that. Some churches are known for their clergy, famous clergy. Nothing wrong with that. Some churches are known for their congregants. They got businessmen and celebrities and congressmen that attend their churches. There's nothing wrong with that. But I believe as lead intercessor and pastor of the kingdom, that God wants the kingdom to be known as a place where Jesus Christ is crowned as Lord, and we are a congregation and community of consecrated believers. Oh, I wish I had an amen right there. See, a lot of congregations are known for having this person in their congregation or this in their congregation. But I want the kingdom as pastor. I want us to be known as we're a church where we have crowned him Lord and Savior. We are a community and congregation, Joe said, that live consecrated, that endeavor to live consecrated lives. Now, we don't always master it, but we're working hard at it. Watch this, Deacon Don. All the honest people, that was a good place for all y'all to say amen. We haven't mastered consecration, but I'm endeavoring to live a consecrated life. Today at the basketball court, as testosterone do with younger guys, two guys got into it, and one guy hit the guy with the ball, and the guy hit the other guy with the ball. And it's always amazing that they look for the older man to get in the middle of him and try to control all that 30-something testosterone. And all I do is put this gray in their face and just tell them, dude, listen, come on, dude, chill. We just exercising. Are you listening to me? You know what I mean? Now, I ain't going to fight now one of them. Them days gone, Pam. I ain't crazy. You know, because before we do this, they ain't doing that no more. They doing this. Oh, they going to their trunk. Are y'all listening to me? And I was, and believe it or not, I'm holding this one dude. This dude's eyes big like he demon-possessed. And I'm holding him small as I am, all buck 60 of me. And I'm holding him like this, but I'm trying to use leverage. We have to. Camera now. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I was trying to demonstrate. I'm holding his, I ain't gonna say his name. We'll just call him Ephraim. And I'm holding Ephraim. And Ephraim was like this, and his eyes are big. And I'm thinking, Lord, I gotta quit this. No, seriously. Because they're gonna look to Fred to kind of rattle. I ain't their dad. I'm old enough to be their dad and some of them granddaddy. Are y'all seeing me? But I got to stay consecrated for my tomorrow. Because here's where I'm going. Because sometimes they get in my face and think, and then, I know you don't like this, and didn't make me want to cuss. Y'all ain't hitting me. Yeah, I'm talking about that's too real for him, Pam. Because I had a 5 foot nothing. I'm short. He's shorter than me. And he talking crazy to me, Elder Verna. And then I said, this young Negro done got in my head and make me want to fight. I ain't wanted to fight in years. I'm being real with you. He about this big, 5 foot nothing. He calling me the N-word like right after. Yeah, nigga. Charles, I looked at that boy. I said, Fred, you actually wanted to fight him? And one dude said, Mo, I ain't never seen you like that. Like that little demon took me there. I came out of my consecration, y'all. I'm trying to say, and don't look so holy when I'm confessing my sins. Don't look so holy, because they out there will take you there. The Staple Singles ain't the only one, Justin, that made the song, I'll Take You There. I got my own version. I'll take you there. Yeah, okay. But as I was saying before I went off on that holy rabbit trail, I believe it's the will of God that we be a community that's living consecrated lives. Are y'all listening to me? Because if we live consecrated lives, it prepares us
for what God wants to do tomorrow. And what is described? Wonders tomorrow. Wonderful things tomorrow. Perform miracles tomorrow. Amazing things tomorrow. Now, we don't want to be known for famous congregants or a famous choir or famous clergyman. We want to be known as a community and a congregation that lives a consecrated life. And when they say, why do you guys endeavor? Listen, now hear what I'm saying. Why do you guys endeavor? Say endeavor. Yeah. That's the operative word. To live a consecrated life. Because if I live a consecrated life, it will affect my tomorrow. And he's promised me, according to Joshua 3:5, he'll do some amazing things tomorrow. He'll do some wonderful things tomorrow. He'll perform some miracles tomorrow, all because I consecrated myself. Anybody with me? So, beloved, what is circumcision? Let's just visit that. This is one of our regular bus stops on the Bible bus. But what is circumcision? Let me give you the natural meaning. The natural meaning, and it makes us men cringe, but it says the natural meaning is the surgical removal of the foreskin of the male sex organ. Circumcision is a cutting away of something. That's why I relabeled it, Patricia. The Christian and circumcision. All right? Circumcision is a cutting away of something. Are y'all listening to me? Yeah. On the spiritual piece, Diane, circumcision is the sign of separation because of a covenant relationship with him. It's a sign, Minister Vincent, of separation because of a what? Covenant relationship with him. Again. Circumcision is a sign of what? It's a sign of separation. It's a sign of what? Separation. Because I'm in a what? Covenant relationship with him. Now, I was going to turn to Genesis 17, but for the sake of it, just put that in your notes. You see Genesis 17, because that's where God first introduced himself to Abraham, introduced to him, I wanted him to, wanted Abraham to circumcise his sons and everybody. We're going to be in covenant. And if you read Genesis 17, you'll read everything that God promised Abraham all because of circumcision. Now, let me give this out the way, Elder Sunithia. Now, don't make light of circumcision because we're going to qualify the New Testament versus the Old Testament. But, Justin, here's how important circumcision was. I think it's in Exodus. Don't try to go there, Essential Team. I think it's in Exodus. So at 17, something like that, don't turn there. But anyway, you may remember when Moses and his wife and those guys was leaving Egypt. And it says, and Moses did not circumcise his son. Did anybody remember what it said God was going to do? God was going to kill who? Moses. Why God? That's how serious God takes circumcision. And it was Moses' wife who performed the circumcision, Valeria, and threw her son's foreskin at his feet and said unto him, you are a bloody man unto me. But what I want you to see is the Bible says that when God saw that he hadn't circumcised his son, that God saw them to kill him. That's how serious circumcision is to God. Are you getting that? You know what I'm saying? Just read it up on your own. Read it. It's interesting. All because I didn't circumcise. If we in covenant, dude, that's it. You got to do it the way I say we got to do it. Yeah. Are y'all hear what I'm saying? Yeah. Here's what, because see, circumcision, again, is a sign of what? Separation. It's a what? A sign of what? Separation. It's a sign of what? Separation. Now listen to these words that you and I have heard ever since we were saved. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, to confirm that separation piece, here's what 2 Corinthians 6, 7, the King James Version says. Wherefore come ye out from among them, and be ye separate. 2 Corinthians 6, 17. Listen now. Wherefore come ye out from among them. Is that it? Yeah. And be ye what? Saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. One of the things I always say, Minister Vincent, hear me, Minister Vincent. One of the things I always try to say to ministers, to myself, to psalmists, and here Pastor Moore, concerning when you have a gift and there's an anointing ministry on your life, you have to guard that anointing. Yes, sir. See, Samson teaches us that. Samson had an anointing on his life, but he didn't protect it. And I teach this, Teresa, over and over to us, not you, because when it comes to that anointing, the anointing, the Bible says, in the book of Ecclesiastes, it says, as dead flies in the apothecary, sendeth forth a stinking savor. And it's an allegory or a picture of when we allow little things to go on and on in our life. It's like little flies, they begin to collect. And the more and more little flies more and more little flies collect in the apothecary of our anointing, it causes it's never the same. And see, the deception is you think just because it's little things, you think it's not messing with your consecration. We think just because it's, because I really mean this, even all through our life, throughout the day, we got to just remember that Satan never leaves us alone. Have I got a witness? Joseph is fair to say, from the moment I woke up, you can have had the holiest and highest sacred devotional. Get in your car. You ain't made it to the red light, and somebody already tempting you with road rage. Have I got a witness? Especially don't blow at me and the light just turned green. Are you listening to me? Because then my flesh want to just sit there for a minute just because I can. Ain't nobody talking to me. Ain't nobody talking to me. She'll tell you. Because I ain't going to lie. I got a little PTSD, Deacon Phil, because one morning I was getting up and I was going home to Louisiana, and I got up about 3-4 o'clock in the morning because I was rolling by myself, and I was on that back road up there in Bastrop and those little country. So I'm driving my car gun, son. And all of a sudden, I see this car coming up behind me, right? And I got my, look, I'm spiritual. I got my gospel music playing, got my coffee. I done anointed my head with oil. Psalms 91, he that dwelleth in the secret place. Anybody with me? Anybody with me? And I'm just rolling, trying to go to my mama's house. And so this car come up behind me. Ooh, you right? I'm like, is he trying to threaten me? And so when he did the last time, I then called 911. I say, I'm on highway 20, whatever that country road is back over there, 71, whatever, I was back there. And I said, there's this guy behind me, and he's acting like he's going. And when I said hit, he did there. Bam! True story. Yeah, he hit me. I punched. I ain't trying to tell you what kind of car I drive, but I was driving a little IS300 Lexus. I punched that little Toyota engine, and then, I ain't gonna lie to you. Fred Moe came out. I said, "Oh no, he didn't," and I whipped that car back around, and I said, "Going for him." Are you listening to me? Now by this time, the po-po is about. And then it's like, what are you doing? Pull over, calm down, and go on home. Because just that minute, I'm telling you, Joseph, I'm driving. I got praise and worship music going. I didn't have my devotion. My head is shiny because I've anointed my head with oil. And the devil still tried to run me off the road. So now what happens is, see, this is why you got to really live that consecrated life. So now, Minister Kim, when I'm driving, and if somebody roll up too close for you, I ain't gonna lie to you, it's almost like I'm back at 4 o'clock on Highway 71 at 4 o'clock in the morning. Because when somebody driving now, you know what, PTSD is real. And so when they're coming up to me, BJ, I say, I know he ain't coming up on me. And then all of a sudden those feelings from back then come up all over again. But my point was, I started that day off consecrated, Carmen. I didn't just get in my car and go. I'm consecrated. My head is shining with the fresh oil of God. And that devil, because he was doing this, and then when he hit me, I was like, this fool really hit me. Some other expletives came to mind, but I didn't say them, Joseph. No, I'm real talk. And then I messed up. I turned the car around and went after him, and that's something they say you don't do. Just leave it alone because you're still alive. Are y'all hear what I'm saying to you? But my point was, I woke up and had consecrated myself for that trip. And it didn't matter with the devil. Because sometimes the harder you fight just to put yourself in a position to be used by him. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You know what I mean? See, the people that say the devil don't bother me like that, I know why. Because you ain't no threat. But if you got that anointing all on your life, ain't nobody talking. If you've been touched by God, are you listening to me? Oh, he ain't listening to nobody that's in, out, some on some time, off some time. But when you, Elder Sunita, got that touch on your life, he will bring all hell against you in various ways. And that's when you got to say, I got to guard the anointing that's on my life. I got to guard the anointing that's on my life. Are y'all with me? So I said all that to say, when it comes to this, see, watch this, Pam, we military. You remember this? Down at the motor pool? We drew all the vehicles we drove, Deaconess Bell. I'm putting all my military folk now. Come on, Major. Major Bo, me and Bo, it was in the Army together. We were sitting in the sauna together. Watch this. Y'all remember these? We had military uniform. I mean, military vehicles. When we drove them, on the side of some of them had for government use only. Right? Now, we still didn't always just go to the motor pool. We still kind of snuck off sometime. Ain't nobody talking. And all the honest soldiers said, Don't lie now, don't lie. You know, sometimes we went to those stores that we weren't supposed to go to, and we weren't supposed to go to in that vehicle. But anyway, on the side of that vehicle, it was for government use only. The state vehicles, with the state of Texas, Louisiana, their vehicles say for state official use only. I'm trying to say to us, why don't we live the consecrated lives where we didn't got to wear the t-shirt that says, but our life says, for sacred uses only. For God use. Are y'all listening to me? I want to live a life where it's obvious that my life, Minister Vincent says, for God use only. For sacred uses only. For holy uses only. Are y'all listening? I'm going to qualify from the Bible. I'm not just going to give you something cute. 2 Corinthians again, 6:17. Because see, part of circumcision is a sign of separation. It's a what? Sign of separation. 2 Corinthians 6:17 says, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. Real quick, essential team, Luke 6:22. Go to Luke 6:22. Go to Luke 6:22. Luke 6:22 says this. Watch this. Luke 6:22, the King James Version says this. Luke 6:22 says this. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company, and shall reproach you, and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. Because see, they're separating from you, and all they're saying to you is, listen, your life is for sacred uses only. Yeah, that's why they can't hang. See, watch this now. Your consecration makes them uncomfortable. Your consecration, Diane, makes them. And listen, it ain't that you're quoting them Bible verses. You just living it. And your consecrated life makes them uncomfortable. And Jesus said, when they separate you from their company, it's a blessing. Because they're saying, what are they saying? You're not like one of us, Minister Z. Oh, come on, man. They ought to be a little uncomfortable with you. And the greatest compliments that they ain't got to say, but the greatest compliments they can say is when they do misspeak around you, they say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Because they'll lose it, Joseph, and say, I'm sorry. And take that as a compliment. What are they saying? They can see on you for sacred uses only. For God used, oh, listen, oh, I'm sorry. They'll say something, Charles, they'll say something. Oh, I'm sorry, Charles, I know you go to church. They've just said to you that your life says for sacred uses only, for God use only. Oh, I thought you'd be happy about that. Are y'all listening to me? So let's get down the road because I've just enjoyed this kind of teaching. Watch this now. David Gussick, one of my favorite writers, says this when it comes to what Joseph said. I mean, what Joshua did with the children of Israel and the men particularly. David Gussick, okay, amen, praise the Lord. Got to watch anytime anything jump off nowadays. Are y'all listening? Okay, then. Amen. What's this? David Gussick said this when he was talking about Joshua's, with reference to Joseph circumcising the sons. He says, circumcision, watch this. This is what David Gussick said. Circumcision was always a powerful act of consecration to God. In it, an Israelite said, listen to this, beloved. In it, an Israelite said, I'm not like the other nations. I listen to God, and I do what he says I should do. I love that. David Gussick writes, when the children of Israel circumcised themselves, they were saying, by being circumcised, I am not like other nations, and you're not like other Americans. Amen. I'm going to say it again. You are not like other Americans. Amen. I am not like other nations. I listen to God and do what he says I should do. Are y'all listening to me? Yes. Now, let's go to a couple of celebrated scriptures on consecration, and then we'll close, because I want you to see that God wants you and I to be what we already are. Are y'all listening to me? Amen. Oh, Jesus. You do remember these verses. Let me just show you. Let me read these in rapid fire. Here's what the Bible says that you and I are already. In 1 Peter chapter 2, the Amplified Bible. See, watch this. Because see, a lot of times, I'm not telling you to fight to become consecrated or holy. I'm saying to you, what Jesus did for us, Brendan, made you holy. Amen. Okay, listen to this now. Here's what it says. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, it says, but you are, Amplified Bible, but you are a chosen race. Amen. 1 Peter 2, 9, see, we must become what the Bible already declares us to be. Amen. We must become what the Bible, say, okay, hear me. As a second-generation preacher with an older brother who pastors an apostolic holiness church, and I don't say this if my brother's watching, he knows where we're at with this. The holiness people are right that God wants you to be holy. But what we got to understand is you and I can't manufacture our own holiness. See, that's where, thank you, babe, that's where we get off at. See, a lot of people try to tell you, you got to manufacture your own holiness. The Bible plainly says your best righteousness is as filthy rags. So everything that I have, including my holiness, I got because Jesus purchased it for me. I'm going to say it again. Everything I got, even the consecration, is because Jesus purchased it for me. Now listen to the Amplified Bible of 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 9. It says this, but you what? Notice he didn't say, Deacon Hollis, but you're going to become. One day you will be. A few days from now. Elder Vernon, he said, but you are. He's talking right now. What am I? A chosen generation. A royal priesthood. A consecrated nation. A special people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellency, the wonderful deeds and virtues and perfections of him who've called you out of darkness. What? 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 11. Listen, just a couple of, I want you to see, if you're taking notes, these are the verses that we must become what we already are when it comes to us being circumcised Christians. And what did I tell you to turn to now? To 6:11, the Amplified Bible. Notice what it says. And such were some of you. before you believed. What? Pam, please catch the tense in which this is written. But such were some of you before you believed. But watch this. But you were washed by the atoning sacrifice of Christ. Watch this, Bo. You were sanctified. So I'm not trying to become sanctified. I'm sanctified. See, that's where I'm saying we clash with people that preach holiness. You think that you can make yourself holy by how you dress. No. When Jesus died for us, he not only purchased forgiveness of sins, but he purchased my sanctification. Listen, and to show you, I'm not taking it out of context, but you were washed by the atoning sacrifice of Christ. You were sanctified. Listen, all of this is past tense. You were sanctified, set apart for God, and made holy. Are you getting it? Let me help you again, Minister Vincent. But you were washed. You were sanctified and made holy. You were justified, declared free of guilt in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit of our God, the source of the believer's new life and changed behavior. Oh, God. So I'm not fighting. I'm not struggling to be holy. If anything, I'm trying to maintain the holiness. I'm not trying to be sanctified. I'm just trying to maintain the sanctified. Oh, y'all listening to me? I'm not trying to. He already purchased it for me. Digna Sarissa, I'm not trying to be holy. I'm already holy. I'm just trying to maintain what he's purchased. I'm not trying to be sanctified. I'm sanctified. But you were. But you were. But you were. But you were. But now you are. But now you are. But now you. So I got to protect that. Okay. Just one other place. One other place. Can I just go a little further? 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9 through 11, the message. Verse 9 through 11. The message. Because hear me, I want us to be a community of consecrated believers, but not people, Deaconess Bell, that's trying to be. See, that's why I clash at with certain, not all, holiness people. You're telling me I got to be holy. That's biblical. But he purchased my holiness. See, Joseph, when I came to him, don't just limit to all I got was the forgiveness of my sins. He made me holy. He made me, listen, he sanctified me. Now, all I'm trying to do is live out what he made me. All I'm trying to do, I am sanctified. I'm just trying to live out sanctification. I am consecrated. I'm just trying to live out consecration. I can't do enough because my best righteousness is as filthy rags. That's what the Bible says. Are y'all listening to me? Where did I tell you to go to Galatians chapter what? 2? Oh, I said 1 Corinthians 6, verse number 9. That's okay. I'm getting excited. We're going to get ready to go. Well, listen, 1 Corinthians 6. I just want you to see this. 1 Corinthians 6, the Message translation, verse 9 through 11, essential team. Watch this. He says, don't you realize that this is not the way to live? Unjust people who don't care about God will not be joining in his kingdom. Continue on, says, those who use and abuse sex, watch this, use and abuse the earth and everything in it, watch this, don't qualify as citizens in God's kingdom. Now watch this though. A number of you know from experience what I'm talking about. For not so long ago, you was on that list. And all the honest people said, yeah, yeah, yeah. Watch this. But watch this. Not so long ago, you were on that list. But listen to this. Since then, you have been, Deacon Don, cleaned up and given a fresh start by Jesus, our Master and Messiah, and by our God present in us the Spirit. Are you with me? Yeah. Okay, so let's close now. Colossians chapter 2, New Living Translation, Essential Team. And I'm going to give you some now. What I want you to see is what circumcision is to the born-again believer, the New Testament believer. Just write these down. We're going to go fast now because we're in our hour and 15 minutes. Colossians chapter 2, New Living Translation, Essential Team. I'm going to read verse 6, then skip down to verse 10 and 13 because I want you to see this. I'm trying to get this in our spirit. Colossians chapter 2, verse number 6, New Living Translation says, and now, watch this, just as you, what does it say? Just as you what? Accepted Christ. Just as you what? Okay, so everything we're going to read is the result, Justin, Vanessa, of me what? Accepting Christ. Everything we're going to read is the result of me what? Okay, and now just as you accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, you must continue to what? Go down to verse 10, Essential Team, real quick. Verse 10. So you also are complete. You what, Joseph? Are what? Through your union with Christ. Watch this. Who is the head over every ruler and authority. Verse 11. When you came to Christ, you were circumcised. Oh, that's good stuff, y'all. That's worth me going over the 5 minutes. When you came to Christ, you were circumcised, but not by a physical procedure. Christ performed, watch this, Patricia, a spiritual circumcision, the cutting away of your sinful nature. Oh, that's good preaching right there, Pastor Mo. That's good preaching. I'm a ham bone all by myself. That's why I tell you, read your Bible. He's supposed to be putting this stuff on you. Don't tell me I'm not holy just because I'm wearing a red shirt and some jeans. Hell, you don't even look like no preacher. You got jeans on and sneakers and in the pulpit. You don't even look like a preacher. That ain't holiness. Please. No. If you ain't never heard nobody tell you that, they there. They would look at me right now, brother. They wouldn't even look at our program. Want me to look at him if I ain't got no suit and tie, I'm black or white? Because my wife knew when I first got saved, I was so blind, all I wore was brown and white and black and white. Am I lying? And my military, black and white and brown and white. And I was holy. I was holy. Couldn't tell me I wasn't holy. Look, military low quarter shining. I didn't even have no regular dress shoes. Pam, I wore them, you know, dress shoes from the uniform. And I was red? Jezebel wrote red. Ain't nobody talking. You got on that red? Jezebel. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Yeah. Yeah, if they had on red, that's Jezebel. And it'd be like this in the church. Child, what child? Jezebel just walked in. Look what she got on there. Acting like they're reaching in their purse. Come on, Elder. Act like they're reaching. Child, what girl? She look at Jezebel just walking here with that red, got that lipstick on. Am I talking? Anybody know what I'm talking about? But see, when you know the Bible and it's right, see, Jesus purchased more than just forgiveness of sins. He says in verse 11, when you came to Christ, you were circumcised, but not by a physical procedure. Christ performed a spiritual circumcision, the cutting away of your sinful nature. For you were buried with Christ when you were baptized, and with him you were raised to a new life because you trusted the mighty power of God who raised Christ from the dead. You were dead because of your sins and because your sinful nature, listen, was not yet cut away. God. Are y'all hearing that? You were. Because your sinful nature had not been what? Had not been cut away. So let's close. Let's close. Go to Romans chapter 2, Essential Team, the Message Translation. The Message Translation. And I'm going to give you two places and then we'll close. Can we do that? Okay. Romans chapter 2, verse 25 through 29. The Message Translation. Notice what it says. Circumcision. Y'all with me? 25 through 29. Circumcision, the surgical ritual that marks you as a Jew. Anybody with me? Yes. It's great if you live in accord with God's law. But if you don't, it's worse than not being circumcised. The reverse is also true. The uncircumcised who keep God's ways are as good as the circumcised. Watch this, Joseph. In fact, better. Listen, better to keep God's law uncircumcised than to break it circumcised. Watch this, stay with me. Don't you see? It's not the cut of the knife that makes you a Jew. You become a Jew by who you are. It's the mark of God on your heart, not a knife on your skin. God have mercy. Are y'all hearing this? That makes you a Jew, and recognition, watch this now, and recognition comes from God, not legalistic. Not what? Okay, so let's close. Anybody with me?
Yes,
Philippians 3, essential team, Philippians 3, and we'll close. Philippians 3, the new living. Philippians 3, verse 1 through 3, the new living. And I'm through. It says this. And that's about it, friends. Oh, that's not it. What happens, dear friends? No. Philippians 3, verse 1. Philippians 3, verse 1. Is that it? Okay, that's not what I have on my notes. Wait a minute. Philippians 3, verse 1. What happens, my dear friends and sisters? Rejoice. I never. Okay, let's read it. We'll get to it. Okay. Let's go. Whatever happens, dear friends and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. I never get tired of telling you these things, and I do it to what? Go ahead. Go ahead, sis. We're going to just read. Watch out. Hey, here we go. Watch out for those dogs. Those people who do evil. Those mutilators who say you must be circumcised. Pam, I'm talking. To be saved. Continue. For we who worship by the Spirit of God are the ones who are truly circumcised. Listen. We rely on what Christ has done for us. We put no confidence in human effort. Though I have confidence in my own effort, if anyone could, indeed, if others have reason for confidence, in their own efforts, I the more. Basically, what Paul is saying is you still got people trying to tell you you need to be circumcised. And Paul is saying we put no confidence in human effort. When I received him, he circumcised my heart. The cutting away of my sinful nature. Give God a hand praise for the word. Now I got a question. Any circumcised Christians in the house? All of us circumcised, men and women alike. And Christ performed the circumcision when we accepted him. Anybody agree with me? Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. And more than just any teaching, we're excited. Because when we accepted Christ, we didn't just receive the forgiveness of sins. You did so much more. We thank you for the spiritual circumcision that took place where you cut away our sinful nature. And it doesn't mean, Father God, that we would not be tempted to sin. I believe it means we would not enjoy living in sin. We're still tempted to sin, and from time to time, admittedly, we make sin. But because you have cut away the sinful nature of sinning, it's no longer natural for us to want to sin. Thank you, Father God, for cutting that out of us. Thank you for cutting. Come on, agree with me. Thank you for cutting that out of us. Thank you for circumcising our heart and cutting that sinful nature out of us when we accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. So we thank you, Lord God. And we ask you by your Spirit to help us to live those consecrated lives where our lives are stamped for God use only, for sacred uses only, for consecrated uses only, Father. And we'll give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right. All right. Any givers in the house, amen? Amen. We want to encourage you to be faithful in your tithes and offerings up on the screen. If you sent your team with workmen, put that up. For those of you online that's watching us, you can give by mail-in, online giving, texting. You can download our app. If you point your phone towards this QR code, we're going to leave it up there for a few seconds. He sent your team. If you point your phone towards that, you can give by that method as well. We do believe in tithes and offerings here at the Kingdom, and we give unto God and unto the cause of Christ. Amen, church?
Amen.
Amen. Let's give God a hand for givers. Amen. Let me just pray over the givers and anyone that might want to receive Christ, and then we'll receive our elder as she comes and closes in our final benediction. Father, we thank you for everyone that purpose in their heart to give to the cause of Christ. From this pulpit, the calling on us is to the common man. That's who heard Jesus gladly, and that's our audience. That's our crowd, the common man. And we thank you, Father God, that as we continue to do so, preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to the common man, we thank you for those that watch us and that support that cause. We're trying to get the gospel to as many men and women and boys and girls as we can, in person, online, through all the different methods and media, Father God, in the name of Jesus. So I just agree with everyone that purposed in their heart to give of their tithes and offerings, Father God, to your cause. You promise, whatsoever man soweth, that shall he reap. In the same measure that he give, the same measure will be given back to them. And we agree to give it back to them in the areas that they need it most. And in case somebody don't know you, Father, we're going to pray this prayer with them. And we pray that if they pray it and be sincere, that you would touch their lives. If you're watching and you do not know Jesus Christ or you're away from God, if you say this prayer and mean it and be sincere. I heard someone criticize preachers who say short prayers because they say you got to say more than that. Nothing can be further from the truth. Peter simply said, Lord, save me. And it worked. Lord, save me. And it worked. The man on the cross said, just remember me. And it worked. If you say it and you're sincere, I'm telling you, he'll meet you. You ain't got to say these long prayers. If you're sincere and honest, remember me is what the thief said on the cross, and he was saved. Peter said, Lord, save me, and he was saved. And if you are sincere, he'll save you. Kingdom family, as a reaffirmation of your faith, say this with me as someone that made me send it online. Say, Dear God in heaven, I come to you admitting I'm a sinner in need of a Savior, and I repent of my sins, accepting Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. Help me by your Spirit to live a life that pleases you and represents the Lord Jesus Christ. In your mercy, restore everything that sin has stolen out of my life. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Give God a hand praise, everybody. All righty. Let's stand to our feet as our elder comes and closes, give our final psalms and benediction. Amen. 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 Amen.
I really enjoy Tuesday night service. Amen. 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 The drive is
Thank you.
The drive that I do is really worth the word that I hear. Amen. Thank God for our pastor and our co-pastor. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Let's see our covering, Psalms 91. And it reads, dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High, shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall with thy feathers, and under His wings shall thy trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noon. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shall thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For He shall give His angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shall they trample under feet. Because He has set His love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Repeat after me. Each one, reach one for him before he comes. Each one, bring one for him before he comes. Each one, bring some for him before he comes. We've entered into worship, let us exit to witness to someone, somewhere during this week. You are dismissed. Amen.